Vermont Senator Bernie Sanders, one of many in Washington, I'm assuming, full of questions about all the talk surrounding adult film star Stormy Daniels and President Trump. I'm kidding. There's also a great many other things to discuss with him, so wasting no time, I'm joined now by former 2016 Democratic presidential hopeful Senator Bernie Sanders. Thanks for being with us. I do want to ask you one question about this thing. Do you think it would have made any difference had this information about this particular alleged affair had come out during the election?
Probably not. And I got to tell you, Anderson, there are enormous problems facing our country.
I knew you were going to say this.
That's right.
That's why I said only one question about it.
There are millions of people who have no health care. People are going crazy with deductibles and co-payments. We can't pay high cost of prescription drugs. We haven't dealt with immigration reform and DACA. We got a gun crisis out there all over the country. People say, let's do something, making sure our schools are safe. And what are we talking about over and over again? Stormy Daniels. Mm. Let me respectfully suggest that I do not think Stormy Daniels is one of the major issues facing our country.
I knew you were going to answer that, but thought I'd ask anyway. Where the administration is right now, I mean, the people leaving, have you, I mean, clearly nobody's ever seen an administration like this. The security clearance issues, the infighting, if it's not signs of chaos, what is it signs of?
It's signs of a president who is, I think, not fit temperamentally to be president of the United States, a guy who, and I say this without any joy in my heart, lies all the time, who changes his mind every other day, apparently based on the last person who spoke to him. So you have an enormous amount of instability, which is of real concern. And I would hope that my Republican colleagues in the Senate would begin to understand that and work with us to start moving forward on the important issues facing the American people. And if we do that, I think you find Trump coming along. But I think we cannot look to this White House for leadership.
You supported tariffs on imported steel in the 2016 campaign. I'm wondering what you think of the president's announcement on tariffs. And I should point out, Peter Navarro just on Fox News just a moment ago just said that that Mexico and Canada would be exempt temporarily, effective immediately.
Look, what I have said over and over again and what I believe is we have a very serious problem in terms of the deindustrialization of the United States of America. We have seen tens of thousands of factories shut down. Millions of hardworking people, decent people, have lost their jobs as factories go to China and Mexico. There are other reasons. Automation plays a role as well. This is an issue that we have got to deal with. I happen to think we need a more comprehensive approach than what Trump is talking about. I think the main target of our concern has got to be China. We have a $375 billion trade deficit with China. Trump, I think, yesterday, said that he wants to reduce that by $1 billion. That is not enough. China is dumping steel clearly all over the world, and I think China is the major country that we've got to deal with. I would personally favor the repeal of permanent normal trade relations with China.
Doesn't a tariff A risk a trade war, and also that while it will help, you know, manufacturing in the United States, it's going to raise prices on cars, it's going to raise prices
It depends on how it is done. But I think that we are in a trade war right now, and we're losing that war. And I think demanding that corporate America start reinvesting in this country rather than in China, you look at your cell phone, I don't believe Apple manufactures any cell phones in the United States. It's all done in China. You can't buy a television manufactured in the United States of America. We have to deal with that issue. And it's not going to be easy. But I think we have to do it in a comprehensive way and demand that American companies are not running to countries where they're paying people $2 an hour while throwing American workers out on the street. That's wrong.
There's legislation in the Senate that would roll back provisions on Dodd-Frank. It's got bipartisan support. Yeah. They say it's going to help community banks. It's going to help credit unions be more flexible in lending. You're opposed to it.
I am strongly opposed to it.
Why?
What this legislation would do is deregulate 25 out of the largest 38 banks in this country. It amazes me how short memories are in the United States Congress. In 2007, 2008, this country was hurled into the worst economic downturn in the modern history of this country because of the greed and the recklessness and the illegal behavior of major financial institutions. And what's happened since the deregulation, since Dodd-Frank, I should say, is we have seen the largest banks become even larger. What the CBO, Congressional Budget Office, reported just the other day, as you'll recall, as they said, this moves us closer to the likelihood of another bank failing. Why would we want to do that? Banks are now making, in general, they have made in the last 2 years, record-breaking profits. Yes, we want to help credit unions and small banks, but banks that are worth $200, $250 billion in assets, those are not small banks.
Do you think a collapse like we saw in 2008 could happen again?
Of course. I mean,
are there enough stopgaps in place?
But this is precisely what they're doing. They're removing some of those stopgaps, and according to the CBO, it will make it more likely that some of these banks may fail, leading to a massive taxpayer bailout. But let me ask you this. I mean, I gotta ask you this. Is all over the country, there are issues on people's minds, you know, whether it's guns, immigration, health care. It amazes me that this is the issue that the Republican leadership has put on the floor of the Senate. And you know why? Last year, the financial institutions spent $200 million in lobbying. Over the last 20 or 30 years, they have spent billions of dollars on campaign contributions. This is the corruption. What you're seeing is the corruption of the American political system. Big money rules, and the needs of ordinary people gets ignored.
During the campaign, Hillary Clinton went after you for your position on guns. You come from Vermont, a state where a lot of people hunt. Do you think there is actually going to be movement on some form of gun control?
I would hope to God that there is. And what we're seeing all across this country is people saying we cannot watch TV anymore and see our children shot down by some lunatic with an assault weapon. So clearly what we have to do, and this is not just me talking, this is what the American people want. They want expanded background checks. They want to end the so-called gun show loophole where you could walk in and without any background check come out with an AK with an assault weapon or a semi-automatic weapon. No background check. They want to end the so-called straw man provision where you can buy guns legally and then sell them to criminals. I happen to believe, and I've believed for 30 years, that we should ban assault weapons. There is a smaller majority of the American people who support that. But be that as it may, gun owners, non-gun owners, understand that the status quo is untenable. We've got to do something. I hope that we will do it. And again, one of the things that I am upset about is that this banking bill, this bill for big banks, is now on the floor of the Senate. We're not talking about guns. We're not talking about the DACA issue. We've got 1.8 million young people eligible for DACA. Some of them may start being deported soon. The American people don't want that. We're not talking about that.
Senator Sanders, appreciate your time.
Thank you
very much. There's much more ahead, including new details about the lawsuit filed on behalf of Stormy.